Now, it may be said, any description we give of it, existing independently of any observers, nevertheless, is a description which is given in our terms, and our terms are all developed from how it does look to us when we are observers. Nevertheless, it seems to me that one ought to be able, if one really does carry through to the end, the assumption, which is itself an assumption of common sense and of science, namely, that the universe does exist in large part independently of any observers, we do start with the distinctions between the properties which it obviously doesn't really have unless they're observers and the ones it does. For instance, let's take an absolutely frivolous example. Imagine the world before there are any human observers, the Earth. Some dinosaur falls over in an undignified way. This could be described from us looking at the outside as ludicrous or absurd or comic. Nobody would suppose that there was any item which, in any deeper sense, was intrinsically comic or ludicrous in this world. It means, would look to us if we were there, ludicrous or comic, with our standards of what's ludicrous and comic, okay? Well, in this matter of describing a world without any observers in it, we have to describe it, as it were, from outside. Now, we form an imaginative picture of a world which is unpopulated by human beings. Of course, we may actually, in forming that imaginative picture of the world unpeopled by human beings, be, as it were, covertly, really, regarding ourselves as an observer of it. It's rather like this present situation. I suppose a lot of people who are watching us have forgotten there's a camera here, as it were. Though, in a sense, it's via such a camera that this scene is presented to them, and only because it's there that it can be so. But, in fact, we can imagine the world without any observers, but the question arises, to what extent are we really writing ourselves in as covered observers of them? And I think it can be argued with regard to certain things like colours, that really we are. What we're doing is describing as the world not as it was before there were any observers, but as it would be if we were there as observers. The thing is this, is that the truth that phenomenalism and all such theories were the view that every statement was to be turned into how it would look.
Yes.
Now, well, the consequence of phenomenalism, I'm sure you'd agree, is the, which I think is a perfectly consistent consequence of that going away, a way of going about it, that is that everything is dependent on the notion of what an observation would be, seems to me the following. Consider, I've taken it in a large metaphysical way, consider two universes.
Mm-hmm.
One's got nothing in it at all. There is absolutely nothing. Or if you like, utterly empty space, if you like that.
No, I don't matter, go on.
Well, if you have a difficulty with there being nothing at all, you just do Hume's trick. You take everything one by one
and
imagine it isn't there. And if you go on long enough, you must get all the conception of there not being anything at all. Okay. Now, that's one universe. The other universe consists entirely of material objects and aren't any observers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, phenomenalism says that the difference between those two universes is just the following, that of one it's true and of the other it's false, that if there were observers, they would have certain experiences. Now, that notion to me is unintelligible. That the only difference between two states of affairs lies in what would happen if something which isn't there were there, seems to be unintelligible. It must be the case that there's some actual difference between them. And it seems to me the only coherent way of describing the actual way between them is in terms of the phrase that I think we've already used, perhaps, of a scientific realism. That is, in the term, the minimum terms that are required to describe what's there in order to explain the perceptions that the observers would have if they were there.
Yes, I don't find this this difference unintelligible, I must say. I mean, I'm slightly happier with it than I am with this notion of an entirely empty universe, which I do find hard to
An entirely empty area of space will do the same. I mean, I don't have to have a universe to make this point. The point, I think, is a rather straightforward one. I mean, it does seem to me that what you're inviting, and what the phenomenalist invited us to believe, is that you could, is something of the same form as the following. That I could have two absolutely indistinguishable empty boxes, which are exactly alike in every respect, except this, that if I were to put a match into one of them, it would catch fire, and if I were to put the same match into the other, it wouldn't. And that seems to me, to use an old-fashioned phrase, rebarbative to reason.
Ah, yes.
That there could be two things which were exactly alike, the only difference between them being that if you did something to one of them, something would happen which wouldn't happen in the other case. Because we'd surely think that statements of the kind, if you were to do so and so, you'd see so and such, must be grounded in an actual difference in the thing.
I do think that, in a sense, we do start with the phenomenalist tradition. We start with anyhow, from the point of view of what we know, with sense experience and sense qualities, and we then elaborate theories to explain them. And I would regard both common sense and physics as, in this sense, a theory. Now, I think where I might differ from you is in my interpretation of the question, what is really there? Because I think that asking what is really there is asking, what theory are you going to accept? And so long as the theory works, so long as the theory is successful in predicting and explaining your experiences, I don't think there is a genuine question as to whether it corresponds to something that is there. Because I think one saying, this is what there is simply a way of saying, this is the theory I'm going to stand by. So if you like, I take scientific realism simply as being opting for a physical description of the world, for the description of the world as you get in the works of the physicist, as opposed perhaps to a common sense picture of the world. But I don't think there is a further question then of this being right, but if being right is distinguished simply from being useful. I mean, I take Pagan's position on this.
Well, now we do have a very interesting, complicated and paradoxical relation here, I think, between philosophy and common sense.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a certain sense in which the position that you've just mentioned is, in a sense, more commonsensical than the scientific metaphysics, some critics would say scientistic metaphysics.
Sense is an option,
as it were. And you're saying there's no privileged sense of what's really there, of the rather more hopeful kind that I was drawing.
Other than, of course, from the sense of certain statements being true. I mean, I'm not going to say there's an elephant in the room if I choose to think so.
Oh, no, of course not. No, I mean, I think we agreed about that. Yes. Agreed about that. But on the other hand, it seems to me your position, which you rightly referred to as a pragmatist position, flies wildly in the face of common sense. And, of course, this just illustrates how ramshackle or wobbly the notion of common sense has been in the discussions of it in recent philosophy, because it does seem to me that one thing that most commonsensical ordinary people would take for granted is quite certainly that there's a lot of things there and that human beings and observers are in the world among other things.
Well, this, of course, I accept. Because
and rather late arrival. Too.
This is what I accept this, of course, because this is part of the theory that I'm opting for.
But then what it does follow that our description of what's there, independently of our arrival and our consciousness, just depends upon what we find useful. And that the question, what's really there, as opposed to our looking at it or our being there, is a question which is about us again. It's about our convenience. And that doesn't seem to me to be. I mean, it may be right, but it doesn't seem to be very obvious.
You're popping in and out of the theory in a way, way I don't much care for. But let's take it concretely. I mean, supposing it were the case that you couldn't represent or plausibly represent the scientific particles as literally parts of the little
this thing
is holding up. Yes, and so one had then to choose between saying, well, it really is coloured, etc., as I see it, or it really is colourless and discontinuous. Then on what basis is one going to choose, other than simply what picture of the world am I going to hold?
Eddington said, he said that there was one table which was the table of common sense, which was solid.
Yes.
And there was another table which was the table of physics, which was not solid.
That's right, yes.
And this was a conflict.
Yes.
I think that one isn't very helpful. Because I mean, there's a very, very shallow and straightforward way of reconciling at that level, isn't there? Which is to say, solid means, for given purposes, not having holes in it of a size sufficient to worry, as it were.
Well, I mean,
so, of course, for the common sense level, it obviously is solid and the other it isn't.
Well, I mean, in this sense, you can reconcile
them. Holes in very small
holes. But this does mean taking the part whole view. What you say is there are a lot of particles that are discontinuous. But they're so close to. I mean, the discontinuities are not perceptible by the naked eye, and therefore, what is in fact not solid looks solid. And again, you have to say that this is a property of colourless particles. that in an assemblage they form an object that is coloured. Now this view can be taken, and then there's no particular problem.
Well,
that view, then you do have to choose, it seems to me, and I can't see on what basis you choose except simply predilection, which picture appeals to you more.
Well, I do think, all I'm saying at the moment is that I do think that that consequence is extremely paradoxical. It seems to me to undermine, in a certain sense, well, let's put it this way, it seems to me to undermine something which, even empirically, and as a matter of common knowledge, we believe to be true. That is, the world existing, that we are in a sense adventitious arrivals in the world.
Yes.
You see, the curious form of all idealism, phenomenalism, verificationism, all these doctrines, is that in a curious way, they're anthropocentric in the end. They make